Hello and welcome to Smart India Hackathon 2019 Designing Digital Solutions Training Program. I am Rajiv Kale, working as a technical trainer at Persistent University in Persistent Systems Limited. In this short course on Python for Data Science Part 1, we will look at some of the features of Jupyter Notebook and also what libraries such as NumPy, Pandas and Matplotlib help us with. So let's begin. The tool that we are going to use now on is Jupyter Notebooks. What is Jupyter, by the way? Jupyter, as you know, is the largest planet in the solar system, isn't it? Jupyter has, in the solar system, Jupyter has many moons. For example, something like 40 moons, and the moons you can see on the picture here, and you can see the three big moons. And they represent, they are Jupiter. The name Jupiter itself has come from Julia, Python and R, and these are the three main languages it supports. We will be using Python, and there are many more in fact which are demonstrated there in the form of smaller moons. So we will be seeing Jupiter features in action. In the following module, we shall practically see things working using Jupyter Notebooks. We will do a demonstrations and see how the code works. Data handling and analyzing techniques as part of Python of data science. These are the few additional libraries that help us to do various tasks such as mathematical operations, database operations, plotting the data, to extract insights. These libraries come along with Anaconda automatically. Let's look at each one of them and see how they help us. So all that you need to have Jupyter on your Windows machine is to install one simple package called Anaconda. You download a latest Anaconda package and just install it. That should give you Python and all the other helper function libraries such as NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Seaborn libraries, so on and so forth. So let's quickly have a glance at what these libraries do. NumPy, this provides us the facility to have NumPy arrays, and which are, as compared to Python list, they have lot of benefits. So Python list have some limitations, NumPy arrays have lots of benefits, although it has some limitation. However, in our case, that limitation doesn't really, really bother us. So NumPy arrays are often used for data science and machine learning because they are convenient to use, they are very fast, very, very fast as compared to your Python list. They are pretty memory efficient, they take much less size in memory as compared to Python list. But what is the one limitation of a NumPy array? Only one limitation is that all the data elements within an array need to be of the same data type. So for example, if your Python list can have different kinds of data types within it. For example, some can be integer, the other can be float, the third one can be string, and so on and so forth. However, the limitation of a NumPy array is that you will have to have all the data elements within an array of one single type. For example, if one is float, then all of them have to be float. However, this particular limitation doesn't come in our way, because in case of machine learning, we are not expected to have different kinds of data within a particular column. So this limitation doesn't really bother us. So because of the other advantages, we will be using NumPy arrays in all our machine learning notebooks. Then there is one more library. This is called Pandas library. This demonstrates how Pandas help us to load the data, extract subparts using conditional SQL type of statements, provides methods to handle missing values, and also makes it easy to create additional columns with synthetic data. This is sort of an enhanced version of NumPy arrays. Rows and columns are identified with labels rather than simple number indexes. It provides a host of tools and methods on top of the data structures. There are main two types, Pandas series and Pandas data frame. Series is nothing but a one dimensional labeled array with index. Index you can specify, it's sort of a key hash value. And the other type is a data frame. This is a two dimensional labeled data structure with columns of potentially different data types. You can extract subpart of the data on conditions. So, you can have conditional statements to extract subpart to work on it. Even for complicated requirement, what we notice is Pandas has mostly a solution in the form of a one-liner code. So, as we will go ahead with notebooks and practically see it, you will appreciate how Pandas library helps us during machine learning. Another great library that we have handy with us is called Matplotlib. This is used for the purpose of plotting the graph from a given data. You can plot bar charts, you can have pie charts, you can have histograms, which are nothing but a frequency distribution on a given data. You can not only plot on the screen, but you can also save such plots in whatever file you want in the form of a PDF. It is a great level of customization. Cosmetics are available. Even in one figure, you can have subplots. This can be done. So, within one figure, different types of plots can be displayed. For example, one of them can be bar chart, other one can be pie chart and all, and so on and so forth. One more library that comes with Anaconda is Seaborn, and it is a wrapper library over Matplotlib. It makes syntax and usage pretty simple. Sometimes if you have an older version of Anaconda, you may not get a Seaborn library. However, that can be installed with a simple one-liner command, pip install Seaborn or conda install Seaborn. We will actually see all of these things in working during practical. There are various data processing techniques as part of a Python for data science, that is handling of missing data and data scaling. What happens is the world around us is not ideal. More often than not, we get data which is kind of a raw data, not a fully filled in data, not a clean data, not verified for correctness and so on. And please remember, whenever we feed this such a data to your machine learning algorithms, you will get the quality of model depending upon how good your data is. So, one of the most important tasks one has to do before feeding data to machine learning algorithms is to ensure that the data is cleaned up, properly filled in with correct values to take care of missing values, and also the data is normalized. What we mean by normalization means there are many columns and some of the columns are varying to a very large values and the other column is in a very small values, then that large value column has a tendency to dominate in the overall model training. So, it is always better to normalize the data before handing it over to machine learning. To mitigate adverse impact, it is essential to scale the data to bring all the features within a common scale. Three transformations are possible here: normalization, standardization, and binarization. Model that the machine learning generates largely depends on the quality of the data that use it. So, just look at the example here. When we do the transformations, so on the, if you see the green dots on the right hand side, that's your original data. Now, there is some kind of a transformation, for example, min max scalar. This will bring all your data between 0 and 1 by transforming it by a particular formula. For example, the minimum of that column is subtracted and it is divided by the range, and that will bring the blue point that you are seeing on the screen is nothing but a transformation done using min-max scalar. There is one more type of transformation that is called a standard scalar, standardization. And if you see green points getting converted into red points there. So, we will actually see a notebook on this, which you will appreciate how this transformation takes place. Let's look at one more aspect of machine learning, and it's called feature engineering. Why is that required? Now, machine learning model may not perform properly if data on which it is trained consists of irrelevant data. identify such features and remove them. You need domain knowledge to doing this. Sometimes just to make data size manageable, especially in case of huge data with many features, you need to identify important features that have more bearing on your target column. So, drop less important features to make data sets small. So, sometimes what happens is your data consists of some columns. For example, if you take a example of a patient's data in hospitals, you will see one of the columns as patient ID. Now, as you will realize, patient ID, that is the patient number, does not really play any role in training the model or impacting the outcome or impacting the diagnosis of a patient. It is just a number. So, typically such columns need to be dropped from the database before you actually feed it to machine learning. So, what are the different ways to identify which feature or which column is important? There are different ways. So, one of the ways is plotting. So, if you plot the data once you get it, you are likely to get some insights. If you don't get, there are some other methods like Pearson correlation matrix, which identifies which features are correlated and which will have more impact on the target column than some others. And the third and the most important is principal component analysis, which effectively transform the data and represent it in a new set of columns in order to have the smaller number of columns, which is nothing but dimensionality reduction. And the whole principle behind PCA is you reduce the dimension without losing much information. In this particular module, we will practically demonstrate how to use Jupyter notebooks and also the features of Jupyter as well as some of the libraries that we will be using for machine learning. These libraries are like NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, and so on and so forth. So, let's begin. We discussed that we'll be using Jupyter tool as your coding method for machine learning models. This Jupyter tool comes with a single package that needs to be installed on Windows machine, and that package is called Anaconda. So, let me take you through how to start using Anaconda. So, if you go to your Windows machine to programs, and if you search for Anaconda prompt, here it is. All that you have to do is click it. This will open a terminal window. Should give you a prompt very soon. On this prompt, what you have to do is first navigate to a path where you wish to store your Jupyter notebooks, or you already have preloaded Jupyter notebooks. So, what you need to do is use cd command and paste a path here where you already have pre-existing Jupyter notebooks or you would like to store your new notebooks. I am already there, so I do not have to do any cd. The next command that you will type here is Jupyter notebook, Jupyter notebook, notebook. Type it and execute it. It will run for a while, and within a minute or so, you expect it to open a new tab on your default browser. So, in my case, my default browser is Google Chrome. So, it will open a new tab in Google Chrome. So, let's wait and watch. So, it's running now. It is using port 8888 and you will see a home tab coming out there. This is your parent tab of the Jupyter notebook. We will navigate to a folder of interest and we will go to something like Jupyter notebooks folder on my machine. In your machines, it can be a different path. So, appropriate path you need to select, and then some of the first notebooks and the concepts that we will be seeing practically are for data science. So, let us go to Python for data science folder. So, I have three subfolders within Python for data science. I'll take you to day 1 folder, and then there are, as you can see, there are many pre-coded notebooks out there. In the first notebook, which is named as Jupyter Notebook Features, I'll open it. The way to open it is just click it, and you will should be able to open a new notebook. These are all pre-coded notebooks. In case I want to go in for a totally new notebook, all that I have to do is go to this new one, select new, select Python 3, and once you click it, you will see a new notebook, a blank notebook opening in a completely new tab. You will be presented with a cell here. In this particular cell, you can write your Python commands, which are executable in Python. And if you notice here, in the drop down, there is a code mentioned here. When there is a code here, that means the contents of the cell will be treated as Python executable commands. For example, I can do something like this, 3 plus 4, this is a valid Python command, and if I want to execute this particular cell, there are two ways to do it. I can click on this run, which will run it, and it will append an additional cell there. I can write one more command, for example, 8 minus 4, and if I want to execute it another way, what I need to do is select this particular cell and press shift enter. Shift enter will also allow me to execute that command. So, this is the way I create a new notebook. How about saving this notebook? There is a save button here. I can save this notebook using this. Then other feature is how to give name to this notebook. As you can see, every new notebook is opened in untitled fashion. So, if you want to name this notebook, go to untitled, click it here, and then it opens a new window where you can enter a new name. For example, I can say my first notebook. I can give this name, whatever name of your choice, you put the name here and then say rename. This renames the notebook from untitled to my first notebook. And then I go on writing my code here, as well as there is other feature is I can even write comments out here. To write comments, typically on a Windows machine, what you would be doing, you would be opening a notepad or a WordPad, writing in notes in that and then saving. Here in the same notebook, you can go on adding comments. For example, this cell contains comments. If I want some comments here, all that I have to do, this incidentally is not a Python instruction. So, if I am treating this as a comment, I will have to select here markdown mode in the drop down, and in go to that cell and execute it. So, this will not be executed as a Python command, but it will be interpreted and it will go in as a comment. So, this is the basic feature of opening a new notebook, renaming it, saving it. If I want to add more cells, I can press on the plus sign, it will go on adding more and more cells. If I want to delete a particular cell, I can select it and use scissors here to cut it off and all that. Many of these functions are self-explanatory. The only one part that I would like to tell you right away is, if your notebook sometimes while running gets stuck, or if it is going in a perpetual loop, all that you can do is go to this kernel tab and then restart and clear output. This will kill the kernel and restart the kernel itself. All right. Having seen some of these features of opening a new notebook, saving it, naming it, let's move on to already pre-coded notebooks. The intention of pre-coded notebooks is to teach you some of the Jupyter features and some of the library functions that we talked about in the first module. So, I am opening a first notebook here called Jupyter Notebook Features. Okay, so I click on that and you will see this pre-coded notebook has opened. You must be wondering that how this image appeared here. Now, this image, what is the code behind this image? So, if I select this cell and click on code instead, I will be able to see what code that particular cell contains, and you will notice that I am giving a path of a particular image and some of the comments. So, naturally these are not Python instructions. So, if I want to execute and bring an image out here, I will have to set this particular cell in a markdown mode. Set it in a markdown mode and execute it with shift enter, and you will see this particular image appearing here. In this way, you can give titles to your notebooks, or you can set whatever image you wish to set. This way you can beautify the notebook with lot of images and titles, and even the titles can be of different sizes, like this one. If you see, for example, this is in the the size of this particular font is big. And how to achieve that? That if you look at the code here of this particular cell, so select this cell and select code here, and you will see that I have put a hash mark here. Now, a single hash gives me bigger size. If I put two or three hashes, the size will start becoming smaller and smaller. So, while executing, I will have to select it as markdown, this being not a Python command. So, look this, now the size has reduced a bit. So, as you go on increasing the number of hashes up to 4, you will see that gradually the size of this title goes on reducing. So, this way you can beautify your notebook. Now, let us move on. Now, I will show you another few magic functions that facilitate better working, especially for machine learning. For example, have you seen a Python command of this type that begins with 2% signs? Look at this command, %write file test.txt. What this file does, what this particular command does is, it generates a new file test.txt in your current working directory, and that contents of the file will be whatever you put here. So, instead of using Windows Notepad or WordPad, you can add whatever notes you make while creating your Jupyter notebook. You can put the notes here itself and just execute this command, and then naturally it will overwrite the file test.txt which was already existing in my current folder. So, I can put whatever comments here, welcome, and execute it, and that file will contain that welcome now. It's a notes file. I added some notes out there. Now, you can imagine if I create a simple file that can contains notes, I can also create some files which will create some usually required, often required functions. For example, if I require a function like giving square of a particular number, I can write it into a file called square.py. Look at this. I can define the function f of x which takes x as an input and returns square of an x, and I put it in a file called square.py. Once I do that, I should be able to import that function in this notebook as well as in some other notebooks. So, what I can do is all those functions which I expect to use repeatedly in either this notebook or in some other notebook, I can create once in this fashion and then reuse it by simply using import command. Okay, let me take you to another beautiful feature of IPython notebooks, and that is creating widgets. It provides a variety of web widgets that can interact with Python code running in the background. And why do we have to use widgets? IPython includes an architecture for interactive widgets that tie together Python code running in the kernel and JavaScript, HTML, CSS running in the browser. These widgets enable users to explore their code and data interactively. So, let's see how to use interactive widgets. For this purpose, you'll have to import one particular library called IPY widgets, and from IPY widgets, import interact. So, let me execute this cell. This import successfully imported. If there is any problem or the syntax error or something does not happen, it will naturally generate an error and the output will be the error. Now, let's take a simple example of calculating a factorial. If I want to calculate a factorial of say x, what is a factorial of x? x into x minus 1 into x minus 2 into x minus 3 up to 1. And there are actually a library functions, ready made library functions in one library called numpy, which I will be using here. So, I define a factorial of x and then print np is a, we will discuss what is numpy and how it helps, but for now let's assume that numpy is a numerical mathematical library that provides us lot of mathematical pre-built functions. For example, it provides us a factorial function and I use it in this fashion. So, I define my own factorial function and then internally I call numpy's factorial function within it. So, let us see how to use it. I define it, this is a definition part and this is the usage part. So, I am using a factorial to find a factorial of 10, for example. So, probably I missed out importing something. So, here it is, factorial of 10 is this. Now, if I want to get a factorial of some different number, what I will do? I will have to go to that cell, manually change the number to say 5 and re-execute the cell, is not it? So, if I re-execute, I will get the factorial of 5. However, this is not a great way of getting output of first of all different numbers. There is a better way of doing it and it is called an interactive function. So, look at what I am doing. I is equal to interact, which I have imported. And I am calling a factorial function, which is this is my defined function, and I am saying that let x move from 0 to 100. So, I am basically defining a range for x, and I execute this, and what I get is I probably forgot to import something. Let me try that again. There you go. So, there was some spelling mistakes. So, I corrected them and now I am getting a beautiful slider here for x where I can change the value of x between 0 and 100. So, the moment I change this slider and change the value of x, what it does internally is call this factorial function, which is my defined function. And this function is called which in turn calculate and the x is passed to this function, which is the value taken from the slider. And then effectively it generates the factorial of a whatever number you want, which is defined through slider. So, this particular feature is extremely useful as far as machine learning is concerned, simply because machine learning algorithms, they often use tuning parameters, and those tuning parameters we need to try different values for tuning parameters, and this makes it very easy using the slider and the interactive function to try out different values as far as machine learning processes go. All right, so this is about this magic functions and interactive function in Jupyter Notebook. Let's move on and let's look at some of the other notebooks. The next one in the line is NumPy Basics. As we discussed during the first module, there were various libraries that came handy to us. One of those libraries was NumPy, and this gives lots of features and facilities to define lists and arrays. So, let us look at the notebook closely and we will understand what way it benefits us. During the first module, we discussed how it provides different advantages over NumPy lists. So, let us open this notebook. To open the notebook, just click on it and it opens this notebook. The first thing I will do after opening the notebook is this notebook is previously run. So, there will be some output coming out there. So, I will do cell, and once I click on cell, I will get various options. So, the first thing I typically do is go to cell, all output, and clear it off. So, all the previously generated output gets erased. So, that is the first thing I typically do every time I open a pre-coded notebook. So, what am I going to learn in this? I am going to compare how NumPy arrays compare with respect to Python lists. So, let me define two Python lists. I hope you are very familiar with Python. So, the way to define Python list is something like this: list A and list B. I am defining two Python lists, and suppose I want to add these two lists element by element. I want to either multiply or add these two lists. Is it possible in Python? All those students have learned Python would be familiar with the fact that you cannot simply multiply or add two Python lists in this fashion. Let us try doing this. It gives an error: can't multiply sequence by non-integer of type list. So, what we learnt is we cannot directly multiply them. If we wish to have element wise multiplication, we will have to do something else. What we can do is we can use indexation and select element after element and run it something in a for loop. For example, I can multiply first element of both the list by using list A into bracket 0 and list B into bracket 0. Or if I want to do it for all the elements, probably I will use some other methods, like for example using lambda function. But how about NumPy arrays? Now, let us see how NumPy arrays behave as far as this property of adding or multiplying two arrays is concerned. So, let us import NumPy as np. Incidentally, this np is my given name. You can give any name. This is just a short form of NumPy, and traditionally people import NumPy as np. So, let me execute this. This is executed. The moment you see the number here, that means this cell is executed. While the cell was being executed, you would see star there, and unexecuted cell would look blank like this. So, how am I going to define NumPy arrays? So, this is the way: array A is equal to NumPy array with some values. I am defining another array, NumPy array with some values. I will execute this. So, it defines two NumPy arrays. Now, as I said, these arrays properties are different than Python lists. So, let us try multiplying these two arrays. Print array A into array B. Let me execute this, and as you can notice, it has done a element by element multiplication. So, first element is multiplied the first element of the second array, second element is multiplied by the second element of the second array, and it has generated the output. So, as you can see, it's a very convenient way. So, what we saw just now is the convenience. So, NumPy arrays are very convenient. I am going to import time now, because we will be checking how they are faster. So, I am importing time, and then I am cross checking again how are they convenient. So, I am defining NumPy array like 1, 2, 3, 4, and I want to multiply it by 5. It simply does element by element multiplication. Addition, in the same way, you can see that two NumPy arrays getting added. Now, let us create Python list. This is a Python list. This is incidentally not a NumPy array, and if I try to multiply it by 5, you will notice, see the result. It has not multiplied every element by 5. Instead, it has appended 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times. So, that is how Python works. However, NumPy arrays are working by element by element operation, and it's very convenient as far as machine learning is concerned. Will be, it's quite intuitive to how humans think. The other property that we discussed during module 1 of NumPy arrays is they are extremely memory efficient. So, let's see how much memory they take as compared to how much memory NumPy arrays take. So, let's create a 1000 element Python list. I want to find out how much memory 1000 element Python list consumes. I am importing sys and importing the length, how many bytes it consumes. So, if you can see, I am getting the size of one element and multiplying by 1000 elements. So, it is telling me that 1000 element Python list consumed 28,000 bytes. And now, let's make a NumPy array of the same size, say 1000, and then I will check how much each consumes and how much total consumes. So, as you can see, 1000 element Python list consume 28,000 bytes. Against that, 1000 element NumPy array consume just 4000 bytes. So, there is a huge difference. So, there the way Python lists are stored and the way NumPy arrays are stored in the memory is shown here. So, Python list requires pointers, and then they keep on pointing to various data segments, and they need not be contiguous, whereas in case of NumPy array, they are stored in a sequence. So, as we saw, two benefits: one is convenience, other one is pretty much memory efficient. Let's see the third one. Let's do some calculations on Python lists and also on NumPy arrays and see whether NumPy arrays work faster. For that purpose, I am importing time. I am creating a big size list or array. So, this size is pretty big. I think it's 1 million, and I am creating two Python lists, L1 and L2, and I am creating two NumPy arrays as well of the same size, and I'll try to figure out the time taken for multiplying the two. For addition. So, what I am doing here is adding x plus y for x and y in zip. What I am learning from here is the Python list took 364 milliseconds for doing that job, and for the same job, your NumPy arrays took only 38 milliseconds. So, there is a huge difference between the time taken by NumPy arrays as compared to Python list, substantially lower. So, they are faster as well. So, that is how these. Let's now look at what way we can create different NumPy arrays. For example, I can create a NumPy array as a one dimensional, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is the values. I can as well create two dimensional NumPy arrays. For example, 1, 2, 3, 5, 5, 6. So, these are three rows and two columns. I can create a NumPy array for all zeros as well, or of all ones as well, and even random ones. Let's see how to slice. So, if I create a random NumPy array of 3 by 4 size, how to extract data of only first column, first row? This is by using indexation. So, basically the first index is talking about which row I want. So, it is the first row that is being extracted. In this case, it will be the first element of first row and first column. In this case, I am going to extract all the rows starting from 1. In this case, I will be extracting all the rows starting from 1 and all the columns up to 2, but excluding 2. So, this is how it will show. I can also get lot of statistics out of NumPy arrays. For example, I create a NumPy array with random numbers of size 3 by 4. So, this is my random numbers, 3 rows and 4 columns. If I want a maximum of this, I can say this data is the name of the array. So, I will be using built in functions like np.max on data. So, what it will give me? It will give me the maximum number out of all these numbers. If I want maximum number of all these numbers column wise, I can say, so in the first column if you see, this is the highest number, in the second column this is the highest number, in the third column this is the highest number, in the fourth column this is the highest number. And how I got column wise? By specifying axis equal to 0. With axis equal to 1, I will go row wise highest numbers. How to find minimum data? NP dot min. In statistics, there will be various terms like mean, median and mode. Mean is nothing but average. So, you sum all the numbers and divide by the number of numbers. In the median is the middlemost number and the mode is the most frequently occurring numbers. For example, if I create a one NumPy array of this type, NP array, with these numbers, I should be able to find out what is the mean of this using NP dot mean. I should be able to find out the median using NP dot median, and I should be able to find out the mode as well using mode. So, what it is telling me is the 8 is the most occurring number, and how many times it occurred? 12 times. In the same way, I will be able to get variance as well as standard deviation on any array that I defined through NumPy. These are still built in functions. You know what variance means, is basically a distribution around mean. Points to remember about NumPy arrays. We saw there is only one drawback, we will just demonstrate that. So, this is a Python list. This consists of 1, 2.0, then some string and then some numbers, and if you print these numbers, you will see that 1, 2, then string and the numbers, and I will be able to get element by element out using index. Now, let us do the same thing through NumPy array. I am having exactly the same data inside the NumPy array, and if you print it, you will notice that all of your data elements are now surrounded by quotes. This happened because one of the data in the entire list was a string. It was an English string in the quotes, and what it did is it converted all of the data elements to that data type. So, effectively what it means is your NumPy arrays necessarily need to have same data type across its all the elements. That is the only limitation it has. However, this particular limitation does not come in our way, because in case of machine learning, we will not be using different types of data types in any of the columns when we receive data from outside or we get data from some source. So, this is about the NumPy. This is a very good library, and we will be heavily using this library throughout our machine learning course. Let us move on. Let us look at one more library called Pandas Basics. This is another library, and in the first module I said that it is the library to be used for handling databases and SQL type operations. So, let me open this and show to you some of the features that it gives. So, the first thing, as I said, what I do normally is go to cells and do all output clear. So, this basically erases all the output generated previously when someone else has run this notebook earlier. Okay, now coming to this first cell, there are two imports here. First import is import pandas as PD. Other one is import NumPy as NP. So, PD and NP are my given names. You can have any given name there of your choice. However, traditionally these are the names you will find in most of the notebooks if you go through notebooks that are available on the internet, and people typically use pandas as PD and NumPy as NP. So, let me start importing it. I run this cell. It has now imported and the cell is executed. First, revise how we created arrays using NumPy. So, I am just revising NumPy array here. NumPy array is of 5 elements. I just created it, and it looks like this in a horizontal list kind of thing, it will show you 1, 2.3, 1 dot, 7 dot 1 and 8 dot. All those dots represented, they are all floats. Now, let me see how pandas series is different than your NumPy array. Now, I am defining a pandas series. We discussed during first module that there are two types, one is pandas series and other one is called pandas data frame. So, let us see what pandas series shows. If I define a pandas series of these 5 elements and display it, you will notice the difference between how NumPy array was displayed and how pandas series is displayed. You will notice that every data element here is now indexed. So, there are 2 columns here now. The first column is nothing but an index and the second column is nothing but the data values. And I can independently access each of them as I want. For example, I can get PS values, which are nothing but 1, 2.3, 1, 7.1 and 8. And if I want to see, look at what are the indexes, you will see that my index starts from 0, it stops at 5 and it takes a step of 1. Now, incidentally, I have not given any indexes here explicitly. What it has done is it has started with an index of 0 and went on incrementing it by 1. However, I can give my own indexes. So, for example, I can replace 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 with something like apple, oranges, mangoes, bananas, guavas and so on and so forth. I can do that as well. How to access an individual element of a pandas series? All that I have to do is the name of the series followed by index in the bracket. For example, PS of 2 returns me 1. Let us look at series as generalized NumPy array. Now, I define PS series with this like this. So, what values I am giving? 1, 2, 3 and 4, and what indexes I am giving? A, B, C and D. If I define it this way and print, you will see that now the indexes are A, B, C and D, and I can extract any value using a new index, for example, C. There is one more feature, series as specialized dictionary. You are aware of what Python dictionary is. So, now I am defining dict as something like this, India. This is like a key value pair, it is like a hash. So, India blue, Australia yellow, New Zealand black, West Indies red and South Africa green, for example, like a t-shirt color, and then I execute and print pandas series with dictionary, and you will see that you are able to get different values if I use a different index. So, basically the first column here, the values in the first column here are working like an indexes, and the values in the second column here are working like values. So, if I say S of 1, I am getting blue out of it. If I say S Australia, I am getting yellow out of it, so on and so forth. Let us now look at how to create pandas data frame from 2-dimensional NumPy array. To create 2-dimensional NumPy array, if you remember from the earlier notebook, we are using something like this, np dot random rand 3 comma 2. This is a 3-row, 2-column NumPy array having random values in it. And I am specifying that I want to give column names as apple and oranges, and I want to use indexes as A, B and C. And then in the next line, I am displaying first 4 rows of that data frame. So, pandas have a data frame. Now, we are looking at a data frame. We have left series behind and now we are looking at the data frame approach. So, this is how I defined and this is how it will look. So, this is a data frame having 3 rows and 2 columns with random values in it. Apple and oranges being the column names which I have specified here. And A, B, C are nothing but indexes. Now, if I wish to get a particular value out, for example, I want a value for B index in apple column, all that I will have to do is, so in the first case, I am just printing all the values. In this case, I am printing all the, uh, sorry, So, this naturally is giving syntax error, and this one should give me for apple, for B, for apple I want a value of B, and it that gives me the right value. For example, if I want to get a value for oranges which are less than 0.5, I can use a conditional statement here, and I am getting the entire row where the values for oranges is less than 0.5. If I don't want the entire row, but if I just want to have values in the apple column with a condition, I can do something like this. Let me now take you to another notebook, and that notebook, okay, before going to another notebook, now we have lots of notebooks opened here, and if I must mention you how to close the notebooks. The one way to close the notebooks is, what you need to do is go to the respective tabs and close this out. That is one thing that you must do, and the second thing that you need to do is go to your home tab. See, you can see the statuses as running in the green. So, you can select running. So, you can notice that there are 4 notebooks running here. You will have to shut them down explicitly by clicking on the shutdown button. So, I am clicking here to shut it down, I am clicking here to shut it down as well, I am clicking here to shut down, and clicking the 4th one to shut down. So, this way when I shut down the notebooks which are running through running tab, then it will shut down the notebooks and it will release the memory back to computer. So, this is what you need to do. Just closing out the tabs on your browser is not enough. But you will have to go to your parent tab, that is the home tab, click on the running, it will show you the running notebooks, and then whatever notebooks you have finished with, you can close them out. So, let me go back to files menu. Now, if you see the status of all the notebooks is not in running mode, I can take you to the next notebook, which is Pandas for statistics. Let me show you what this notebook contains. This is used for data analysis. For example, I will do cell all output clear, that is my starting point, and here is a data set. This particular data set is about the weather data set. The data set is shared with you and you need to answer the following questions. So, we are going to do some data analysis now. What is the maximum temperature? On which days there was some rain? What is the average wind speed? And we will have to answer these questions by doing analysis on the data set. Now, this data set, if I click, it will be in the form of a Excel sheet. Let me click it and let me see what it shows. So, it has downloaded to my machine. Let me open it and show it to you what it contains. So, I am opening that Excel sheet. While it is doing that opening, let me take you further down, because we will not be working on the Excel sheet. Typically, with the knowledge that you already have on Windows and Excel, this is the kind of data you will see, that there are various columns. The first column, for example, is your date column. The second one is the temperature column, the dew point, humidity, sea level, visibility, so on and so forth. So, there are some 8-10 columns here, which contain lots of data. So, this is in a form of an Excel sheet, and we will be loading this data set through Pandas. Let us see how to do that. So, if you look here, I will be importing Pandas as PD, and what I am doing is there is a function called read CSV. So, Pandas has a built in function read CSV, and I am going to use that function and specify the path of my CSV file in the bracket. So, this is how I load the data from the disk drive, from the data, the CSV file, and then ultimately the data loaded goes into something called data frame. The name of the data frame here is DF, to the left hand side of my equal to sign. So, DF is a data frame which has a loaded data, and then I can visualize that data on the screen by using df.head. So if I don't mention anything here, it by default displays 5 lines of data. So as you can see, df.head. If I want more data, I can say df.head10, which will give me 10 rows of data. If I want the last few lines, I can even say tail instead of head, and it should give me the last lines. So this is a 30 rows data, and it's giving me from 21 to 30. And what kind of data it is showing? You can see the same column names: date, temperature, dew point, humidity, so on and so forth. And now we need to analyze this data and attempt to answer these questions. What is the maximum temperature? On which days there was some rain? What is the average wind speed? And then how to go about it? So let's see how we handle this data. So what is the maximum temperature? So there is a one temperature column here. So what I can do is I can use data frame as my starting point. In the data frame, then opening bracket, within that opening bracket, in the bracket we can say temperature in quotes. So that specifies a column, and then we use a max method, and then that should return us what is the maximum in that particular column. For example, if I execute this, it will generate that in this particular column it found 50 as the highest number for temperature. In the same way, I can find even a min. For example, if I replace max with min, I should be able to get what is the minimum temperature. So minimum temperature is 20 and maximum is 50. Now what is the second question asked to me? On which days there was some rain? So what I can do is, basically what it is looking for is it has to have some rain. Now whether it rained or not is given in what column? It is given in events column. If you see events, it has a snow, then fog, then some null values, somewhere it is mentioned as rain. So I can put a conditional statement out here saying df events equal to rain, means return me all the rows where there was some rain. If I execute this, I will get these 4 rows where you will see that events has mentioned rain in it. Now in this case you will notice that the entire data is written, but what is asked is I am looking for only the dates. I do not want what was the temperature, dew point, humidity, so on and so forth. So for a given condition on a particular column, what I am looking for is not the entire data frame with meeting that condition, only the particular column. So I am interested in dates on which a particular, say for example, give me dates where temperature was more than 36 degrees. I can do something like this. I can write df opening bracket est followed by df temperature greater than 36, and if I execute that, see the difference between this output and this output. This output is giving me only dates. The upper output is giving me all the columns. I am looking for a date column here, that is why I mentioned df est. What is the average wind speed? How to get average wind speed? There is a wind speed column here. I wanted to calculate average on that column. All that I have to do is wind speed, select df wind speed MHP and use a mean method. If I execute, it gives me that the average wind speed is 6.89. There is one more method available for data frames, which is called a describe method. This particular method helps you to get the statistics on all the columns. For example, if I run it in this fashion, you will see that for all the columns, it gives you how many values are there. So these are the number of rows. Then there is a mean row, which gives you what is the average. It also gives you the standard deviation, what is the minimum in that particular column, what is the maximum in that particular column, and all of that. So for example, if you can see, minimum for temperature is 20, maximum is for 50, average is 34, so on and so forth, and it gives it for all the columns. So one simple method called Describe on data frame gives you the entire statistics or the snapshot of statistics on your entire loaded data. This on many occasions facilitates us to find out the outliers in the data. Supposing there is a temperature column in the temperatures in the city, and if you notice that in one particular column in that temperature column in one particular row, the value mentioned for a city's temperature as say for example 240 degrees, then obviously you will see you will realize that this is a abnormally high value which you typically won't find in any city, and you can think of it as a typographic error, and you can go back and correct your data set, remove this outlier before you use this data for any machine learning processes. Another way, if I want the all the entire data for temperature more than or equal to 30, this is the way to get it. Suppose I need a data for a temperature greater than 30 and humidity less than 50, then I can even use conditional statements using logical operators. For example, I can do logical ANDing or I can do logical ORing. So, this way I can execute this and it will give me the entire data for having temperature greater than 30 and humidity less than 50. If I need entire row data when dew point was maximum, I can run it like this: df dew point is equal to df dew point maximum. I can run it this way and I'll get one row which meets this condition. If I want not the entire data but only a particular column, I can select the column here to start with and then the condition. So the syntax you need to remember is you first select the column you want. If you don't mention the column, it will be the entire data returned to you, followed by a conditional statement. Another important feature that I am taking you to is group by functionality in pandas. A data set called weather by cities is shared and you need to answer following questions. What is the maximum temperature in each of the cities? Find the average wind speed per city. If you want answers to such questions, what you need to do is you need to filter the data out by cities. The best way to do is by grouping. For example, let me read this data. This data is stored in weather by city CSV file. I am using pandas read CSV function. I am doing it, I loaded the data and this is how the data looks. So, if you see in the first column there are days, that's dates. In the second column we have city. For example, New York, Mumbai, Paris. In the third column, fourth column, there are temperatures and wind speed, and in the last column there is event, whether it rained or snow or sunny, all of that sort of thing. Now, if I want to get temperature by city, what I can do? Get me temperature column for DF city is equal to New York and the max of it. I can do it that way. The other way to do it is to do grouping. So, this is the group by functionality of pandas data frame. So, you can do df dot group by, and on what I am doing grouping? On city. For example, there are three cities, Mumbai, New York and Paris, and this will generate g which I can use subsequently. So, data frame dot group by on city generates a g, and later on I can use that g to get out some information on a particular city. For example, g dot get group Mumbai max. This way I can get the maximum of everything for a city named Mumbai. For example, I am an Indian, I am living in India and I am interested in looking at the statistics of only Indian cities. I can get it easily like this. So, what it typically does is look at the operation what it does. When you do group by, it splits your entire data set by cities. For example, there are three cities and in this case it has split it one subset for New York, other one for Mumbai, other one for Paris. So, effectively it has separated your entire big data into three smaller datas city wise. So they are grouped by cities, and then you can work on those individual parts with the conditional statements that we have learnt earlier and extract whatever intelligent information you wish to extract. So the whole operation is like this. The process is called split, apply and combine. So first is the first step, you split it city wise, then you apply the conditions. For example, I want an average for Mumbai, for New York and for Paris, get it out and then combine the result and display it and return it back to the user. So these are some of the brilliant features that are available in pandas. It makes our life very easy. All right, I hope you understood pandas features. Now let me take you to another library, and that library is called Matplotlib Basics. So this is a for plotting purpose. This particular library is used for plotting the data. Let me open this notebook and show you how it works. So as usual, the moment I load preloaded notebooks, the first thing I usually do is cell all output clear, and what it does? It erases all the output generated by previous runs of this particular notebook. So let me start with this new library called Matplotlib. In the first cell, you will see import matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. So I am going to use a short form for this. So subsequently in this notebook, I will be using this library with the starting as PLT. So let me execute this. It is executing. First import takes some time, but later on import works very fast. So it in no time it can do that. And let me show you how to use it to plot the graphs. So I am using plt.plot and giving you 4 data points, 10, 20, 30 and 40. And I am going to say plt.show and look at what it plots. So this is the plot it has drawn on the screen. You must be wondering, while you plot points, you need coordinates, isn't it? So you would need x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3 and x4, y4. However, in this particular case, what we are doing is, we are just giving 4 values, 10, 20, 30 and 40. And you must be wondering, where am I giving x coordinates? So if I, how it works is, if I don't mention x coordinates, by default it takes their values as 1, 2, 3 and 4. So in on this particular graph, you will notice that the line it has drawn is for 110, 220, 330 and 440 kind of thing. So this is how it works. It starts from 0, not 1, 2, 3, 4, but x index starts from 0, 1, 2, 3. So it has plotted graphs like 0, 10, 120, 230 and 340. So it has assumed x values at 0, 1, 2 and 3. But if I want different values, I can definitely specify. And another thing that I must mention is, you need to use this particular command, percentage matplotlib inline. What this does is, it plots the graphs within the notebook. Instead of opening another tab and plotting it in a different screen, it opens it in the same notebook. So the first thing you should do while using matplotlib is have this line in have this command in your first cell, matplotlib inline, if you want those plots to be within the notebook itself. So I am executing it. How to draw multiple lines in the same plot? For example, I am going to show you a beautiful way of plotting 2 different curves here. So I am importing, and I am using numpy's line space function. This line space, what it does is, look at the parameters that I am giving. I am saying that generate 256 numbers starting from minus pi to plus pi. I hope you know pi. 3.14. So it will generate 256 equally spaced numbers between minus 3.14 to plus 3.14, including both the endpoints, and this is how my numbers will look. So, I am generating synthetically these points to be used for plotting purpose. I am going to use these points to generate sine wave and a cos wave. For example, so what I will do is S is equal to numP sine x. Now, my x is this, x consists of array of how many points? 256 points. Which 256 points? Generated by a function called numP's line space. So, these are my 256 points. I am using those points, that is x, using a numP function called sine. So, np dot sine of x, and the result will be placed into capital S, and np dot cos into bracket x, the result will be placed into capital C. So, now capital S and capital C are nothing but my sine wave and cos wave. So, let me execute this cell and plot it as well. So, let us see how the plots look. Now, this is how the plots look. Now, one thing to notice is I am not mentioning any scale. I am not mentioning which curve is a sine wave, which curve is a cos wave. So, all those things I can start putting one by one. How do I add a legend? So, I need to mention which color is for sine, which color is for cos. I can do it this way. So, plyplot label cos, label sine, legend and show. You will notice that now the legend has gone out in the plot. In the left hand top corner, you can see blue line indicating cos, orange line indicating sine, and this is how you can segregate the two curves, one being a sine curve and the other one being a cos curve. Now, let us look at how to increase the figure size and resolution. I can do it by using figure size mentioning 8,3 and dots per inch as 280. So, if I do that, I will get a bigger size plot here. I can also add grids, because there are, if you can notice on this particular graph, there are no grids. So, if you put grids, it will be easier for you to read the graph. So, let me add grids. So, you can see that grid is getting added. So, in every cell, I am showing you how to go on improving your graph. So, one thing we did is add legend, the other thing is we change the figure size and resolution, the third one which we did is to add grid to the graph, and now I will show you how to add axis limits. So, my axis limits will be 0, 5, minus 0, minus 0 or 0 and up to 1. So, I can add something like this. So, if I start a graph from 0 to 5 and 0 to 1, it will be very easy for me to understand which is a sine wave and which is a cos wave, isn't it? For example, sine of 0, as we all of us know, it is 0 and cos of 0 is 1. So, from that axis limits also, I can make out which one is sine wave and which is a cos wave. How do I add axis labels? Now, x axis and y axis do not have any labels at the moment. So, if I want to add them, I can do it like this, plt dot x label, this is x axis, plt of y label, this is y axis, and then add the label. This is how I add the labels. So, now you can see explicitly mentioned labels appearing here, this is x axis, this is y axis. How to title my graphs? So, at the moment there is no title to this graph. I can title the graph using plt dot title function. So, what I can do is, I can execute this and you will see this title appearing here, my first Python plot. How do I decorate graphs than this? So, one of the ways is I can show it to you right here and you will see how I can draw a line like this. So, look at what kind of customization I can do. I can mention the color to be red. I can also mention line style to be dash and dot, for example, like a dash and dot here on the line. I can define the line width, I can change that, I can say marker use as O, and then I can say that marker face color to be yellow and marker edge color to be green, then marker edge width to be 3 and marker size itself to be 12 and so on and so forth. So, the point here is that you can do lots of customization if you wish to. There are facilities. This library provides a lot of customization possible to use to make your graphs more meaningful and impressive. And the last thing that I would like to show in case of Matplotlib, and of course the interactive function that we have learned at the beginning of this particular module, is using interact function and widgets. So, let me import a widget. What I am going to do is, my whole objective is to show you the plot of one particular function. That function is ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d. For example, I want f of x to be ax cube, bx square, cx plus d, and my a, b, c, d are my variables. So, if I, as you know, the equation of a straight line is y equal to x plus c, but as you go on increasing degrees, you will find that the line starts taking curves, and these are now tunable parameters in my hand. So, for example, I can not only change a, b, c and d values, but I can also change the color of the graph, line style of the graph and line width of the graph, all with interactively. So, for example, I can change the value of a and see how it impacts. So, if I change the value of a to some different value, you will notice that the line has changed and started taking curves. So, if I do something like this, for the different value of a and b, it is giving me a different kind of graph. I can change the color from red to blue or to green, and the solidity from solid to dashed, and all those things. So, these are all related to decoration and playing with cursors. Line width I can increase, I can make it much bigger or much smaller. So, the moment I touch any of the slider or drop down values, it facilitates me to, it immediately calls the function that is defined under interact, and it will replot the graph. So, this is another thing. And the very last thing in this particular notebook is to show you what the histogram is. So, basically histogram is nothing but frequency distribution. For example, let me start with a simple example. In this particular, let me comment this out. When I put a hash before the line, it is a comment. I am removing this comment to define y is equal to a simple numpy array of these values. So, there are three threes, some fives, many eights and two nines. So, then my y will contain these numbers. This is a numpy array, and I am going to plot a histogram. So, histogram is nothing but distribution. So, I plot, Matplotlib provides me a built in method called hist, and if I execute it, you will see a histogram of this kind. So, as you can see in this, so it is telling me how many threes are there, how many fives are there, how many eights are there and how many nines are there. So, this is how it shows the frequency distribution. This is in simple to understand what frequency distribution and histogram is. Now, taking it further and doing it for say 1000 numbers, I can redefine y and I can replot it, and you will see that there are various now as you can see, it cannot have for 1000 numbers, you cannot have 1000 buildings shown on the graph. So, what it does is it brings certain groups together, and in the groups you will see that various buildings. So, if you add all of these buildings together, the eventual your resultant number will be 1000. So, basically there are quite a few in this region. So, between around 0 and minus 1 plus 1, you are finding around 200 odd values contributing to that overall 1000. So, if I want to make not 10, if I do not mention that how many groups, it takes 10 as groups, but if I want to mention more groups, I can say make 20 groups, and then you will notice that instead of 10, it has made 20 such buildings to show you. Another thing is, it can draw bar charts. For example, for 1, 2, 3 on x axis, 30, 40, 50 on y axis, you can have a bar chart of this nature. You can also have pie charts. Okay, so it will look like this: cats, dogs and fishes. These are the labels I am attaching. I am mentioning x values as 45, 35 and 20. And then this is how the pie chart, beautiful looking pie chart with different colors, can be shown. So this is the way we can draw histogram, bar chart, pie chart, and of course the exploded pie chart in a single figure. So this gives a facility to have four different plots in one figure, which gives very impressive look to your overall drawing. And not only that, what it also offers us, that it allows us to save this particular figure into a particular file. For example, I am using a command here, plt.savefig, and the name I am giving is first.pdf with a dpi of 200. So for different resolutions, I can mention with what resolution I want this plot, and also the name of the file in which it will get stored in my current directory. So that, and then once it is saved, you can redistribute it, reshare it with your clients and all that. So this is how overall matplotlib library routine works for us. It's a beautiful library and we'll be using it throughout our notebooks. We looked at some of the features of Jupyter Notebook. We also looked at some of the libraries such as NumPy, which gave us amazingly fast, convenient and memory optimized NumPy arrays. Later on, we looked at Pandas. That's another library which helps us load databases, carry on SQL type operations, extract data based on conditional statements and so on. After that, we looked at another library called Matplotlib. That library helped us plot the incoming data in various forms. In this particular module, we will be covering the balance topics, including a library called Seaborn, and later on we will shift our focus on data pre-processing. So let's start with Jupyter Notebooks. I had shown you how to start Jupyter Notebooks. So on your Windows machine, look for Anaconda prompt. Click on Anaconda prompt, that will give you a terminal window. Once that starts, you should see, what you need to do is basically navigate to a folder where you wish to store your new Jupyter Notebooks, or you already have pre-coded Jupyter Notebooks, and then say Jupyter Notebook, JupyterNotebook, Jupyter Notebook. That's the command you execute. It runs for a while, for a minute or so, and then what it does is, on your default browser, in my case it's a Google Chrome browser, it will open a parent tab, which is nothing but your home tab. On this home tab, you can navigate to whatever folder you wish to. So I am going to Python for Data Science. I am going to day one in that, and I'll be opening a notebook called Seaborn Basics. So this notebook is now being opened. The first thing I do when I open a new notebook is to go to Cells menu and clear all output, so that all the output that was generated previously is erased. Now, before we actually start using Seaborn as a library for plotting purpose, I need to give you some background on what kind of data set that we are going to use here. So as we go along executing cell by cell, I'll explain to you what it is doing. Basically, this is an iris data set. So iris is the name of the flower. This data set is very popularly used in various machine learning trainings. This is also available at many places for download, and in fact, because of its popularity, scikit library has included this data set within itself, so you don't have to go outside to fetch this data. Just to give you a background, iris is a flower and it has three species: setosa, versicolor and virginica. So all these species collectively make an iris flower. And how are these spaces determined? The kind of space it is based on the size of two elements of the flower. One of the elements is called petal and the other element is called sepal. As you can see in this picture, the top part is petal and the bottom part is sepal, and there are four dimensions: petal width, petal length and sepal width and sepal length. So, based on the various values of these four dimensions, basically the type of flower is determined. For example, look at this table here: sepal length of 5.1, sepal width of 3.5, petal length of 1.4 and petal width of 0.2 decides that it is a setosa kind of species. Look at the bottom most row here, that is 150th sample. If you have 5.9 as your sepal length, 3.0 as your sepal width, 5.0 as petal length and 1.8 as your petal width, then this particular flower can be categorized as a virginica. So, basically we have a data set that gives us four columns as input features. We call it as features or attributes or columns. Now, this is your input, it is all giving you a dimensions of the flower, and the last column, which is called a target column or a class column, we have three values: setosa, versicolor and virginica. Let us see how to load this data. So, in the first cell we have import pandas as PD, which is nothing but we are going to use pandas library. In the next cell we are using pandas read CSV function, which is nothing but loading the data set iris.csv, and if you see the first five rows you are seeing something like this. You can also see tail if you wish to, so you can see the bottom five rows in this fashion. Once that is done, using data frame value counts method, we can find out what are different, how many different numbers are there for each of the class. For example, in this particular data set we have 50 samples of versicolor, 50 samples of setosa and 50 samples of virginica. The next is the matplotlib library we are familiar with, and now in the next cell we are going to use for the first time seaborn as our another library, which is sitting on top of the matplotlib. This is nothing but a wrapper on top of matplotlib, and it helps us with lot of different kinds of plots. We will be seeing in this notebook what different kinds of plots we can get. we have also seen a group by functionality, where for the entire data set we split it into different section based on species in this case, and we can check the histogram. For example, this histogram is nothing but a frequency distribution. So, if you can notice here, around 0.2, 0.25, most of your data samples are accumulated for setosa kind of species. In this same fashion you can get it, for example, you can get a mean for a petal width, like in this case 2499. To another thing I am telling you here is extract some part of your iris data frame. So, this is a conditional statement: extract all the rows where species is equal to setosa and put it in a new data frame called df underscore setosa. That is what I am doing here. So, my original data set remains in, and I am extracted some. So, how many setosa samples we have in our database? If you go up and see, there are 50. So, in our new data set there will be 50 samples. Now, what kind of different plots we can have on this using seaborn? Let us see one by one. So, here we are getting histogram. In the next cell we can see scatter plot. Scatter plot is nothing but the points plot without any lines, and which two dimension I am considering? Petal length and petal width. However, the most important part to note here is u equal to species. What it effectively does is based on this. Now, you will see this blue. to do classification on this, you can from this plot itself you can make out that we can easily separate out setosa type of flowers using a simple rule based operation. Like if petal length is less than 2.5, the flower species will be setosa. So this is, but the other two flowers you can see they are badly mixed up. I mean, just by a simple rule you may not be able to classify them correctly. In such a case, we will have to pass this data on to machine learning algorithms which will help us classify this. Later on machine learning in our next module, however, at this moment we will see what kind of different plots seaborn gives us. There is one more plot called box plot. This gives you another view. Like you can see here, two boxes are overlapping each other. One more kind of plot is strip plot. Here also you can see an overlap, but you can get to see even more detail in the form of points. So you can make out how many data points of brown and how many data points of green are overlapping. In the same way, we can get another view called violin plot. Here also the width of the violin gives you some idea about how much the overlap is. Clearly, blue one is a completely separate which does not have any overlap. And the last plot that we can see here is kernel density plot, which gives a complete clear picture about how setosa looks and how the other two are overlapping with their hills here overlapping, and you can get the area which is coming under both the curves. So these are the different plots you can get through seaborn library. Thank you for going through this module on Python for Data Science part 1. In the next module, we will focus on data preprocessing techniques, which is essential part of machine learning. During the data processing techniques, we will see how to handle missing data, how to handle text data, how to scale data, and feature engineering. See you soon. Thank you.